Hi everyone, this is Fabi here, and in today's video I'll be explaining memory addressing types. I also recommend you watch last week's video in which I explained registers, as these topics really go hand in hand. Understanding these two topics will enable you to inspect the assembler code, which is going to be generated after you're going to write your C code, and this is also going to allow you to more easily debug your code. If you're new to the channel, this video is part of a series I'm doing named Embedded Systems Explained, and the aim of this series is to teach all of the essential concepts of embedded systems in a simple to understand manner and with examples so you know how they are going to be used in the real life. I will leave a link to the playlist in the comment section down below in a pinned comment, so make sure to check it out if you're interested. So why should you bother learning about memory addressing types? After all, when you're writing C code, you're not going to even bother with these memory addressing types because it's all going to be done for you automatically. And that's true, but in order to understand how things run under the hood, and this is important if you want to do some optimizations, you have to look at the assembler code which is going to be generated after you write your C code. Without understanding memory addressing, you won't be able to figure out how data is being accessed as part of assembler instructions. Furthermore, if you're thinking about diving into writing assembler code, it's going to be essential to know how and when to use each of these memory addressing types. Stay tuned until the end to find out how you can experiment with memory addressing at home without buying any new hardware or any microcontrollers. Just like in last week's video, the architecture we are going to examine is going to be that of the Texas Instruments MSP430 family. There are 7 addressing modes available, namely register mode, indexed mode, symbolic mode, absolute mode, indirect register mode, indirect autoincrement mode, and immediate mode. Don't worry, some of these are actually quite similar, so it's going to be easy to understand. And just like in Texas Instruments documentation, we are going to take a look at how each of these memory addressing modes can be used as part of the move instruction. Before starting, it's important that you know that every instruction will require either a source, a destination, or both of these two. You need to keep this in mind, as not every memory addressing mode will work for both source and destination operands. The first addressing mode, named register mode, is one of the easiest to understand. This can be used for both source and destination operands, and the syntax is easy. You just write the register name, and the content of the source register is going to be moved to the content of the destination register. Using register mode, we can work with both 8-bit data, which is a byte, or with 16-bit data, which is a word. Given that we only work with data stored in CPU registers, this addressing mode is going to be the most efficient as far as speed and code space goes. To my right, you can see an easy example of how this works, and you can also see that after running the instruction, the program counter is automatically being incremented so that it points to the next instruction. If you want to know more about the program counter, make sure to watch last week's video, as I explained all of the CPU registers in that video. The second addressing mode, named indexed mode, treats the contents of the registers as memory addresses. So these are going to tell us where we should fetch data from in case of source operands, or where we should store data in case of destination operands. Moreover, we can add an offset to these addresses by writing a number before the register name, which, as you can see, is written inside brackets. In the example on the right side of the screen, you can see that we are moving the contents found at the source address, which is going to be the value of R5 plus 2, to the destination address, which is going to be the value of R6 plus 6. Keep in mind, these will be hexadecimal numbers, so unlike decimal numbers, which have 10 symbols from 0 to 9, hexadecimal numbers have 16 symbols, so from 0 to 9, and then from A through F. So going back to our example, the content of R5 is 1080, plus 2 means the source address is going to be 1082. Similarly, to find out the destination address, we need to add 6 to the value of R6, which is 108C. So by adding 6, the result is going to be 1092. Of course, again, hexadecimal numbers. Just to be clear, while you're using this addressing mode, you're not going to actually alter the contents of the registers. You're just going to use the contents as source or destination addresses, so nothing is going to be changed as far as the registers go. This addressing mode is useful, for example, when you're using a lookup table, because you can store the starting address of the lookup table in a register, and then you can read or write to it by just referencing the register and then an offset address so that you can cycle through your lookup table. Just like with register mode, you can use this addressing mode for both source and destination operands. The third one, symbolic mode, is implemented through index mode, but the register being referenced is always going to be the program counter, which is one of the CPU registers. The syntax for symbolic mode requires us to write the source and destination addresses, and then the offsets between these addresses and the program counter are going to be calculated automatically. These offsets are again needed because this is implemented through index mode, and as I told you before, index mode expects an offset before the actual register. So in the end, the address is going to be the value of the program counter plus the offset, which is always going to be equal to our desired address, which we just typed in. Let's take a look at a short example so you can better understand what I'm trying to say. So let's say that our desired source address, which you are going to type in the instruction, is going to be C020. Let's then say that our destination address is going to be C120, and the program counter is currently C010. For the first operand, the calculated offset, or the source address minus the program counter, is going to be 10. After this, the program counter automatically gets incremented by 2, so our new program counter is going to be C012, which leaves us with an offset for the second operand of 100E. The beauty of symbolic mode is that all we have to do is just type in the source or destination address, and the rest of the work is done for us. Absolute mode, just like symbolic mode, can be used for both source and destination operands, and all we have to do is write in the address, just like with symbolic mode, but preceded by an ampersand. This actually gets converted into an indexed addressing mode, with the register being referenced having a value of 0 and the offset being our desired address. The register being mostly used to store this 0 value is the status register. By taking a look at the example on the right side of the screen, you'll be able to see that the offsets, again, just like I told you, are equal to our addresses. Now that we finished with the three addressing modes, which are based on index mode, it's time to move on to indirect register mode, which only works for source operands and uses the content of the register after the at sign as the address for our operand. Essentially, this works like pointers in C. The pointer, or the register in this case, stores the address of the value we are interested in. Just like it was the case with indexed mode, the contents of the register are not going to be altered because they just store the address of the values we are interested in. An interesting addressing mode is the indirect autoincrement mode. This is similar in syntax to the indirect register mode, it just has a plus sign at the end. The auto increment naming comes from the fact that the value of the register being referenced gets automatically incremented by either 1 or 2, depending on the operation type, after the operation takes place. This means that we can read from successive addresses without having to explicitly increment the value of the register. And as you can see from the example to my right, you can see that the value of R10 gets actually incremented automatically. Just like indirect register mode, this only works for source operands. The last addressing mode, named immediate mode, is really convenient when we are trying to use a constant as a source operand. All we need to do is write the hash sign, and after the hash sign, we can input our desired value. If this value can be generated with the constant generator, which I talked about in the last video, then it's going to be even easier and more efficient, because this can be used to generate that constant. The way this is implemented is that the program counter will actually get automatically incremented after the instruction is fetched, and so it will actually now point to our constant. As you can see from the example to my right, this is actually implemented through indirect auto increment mode, which we just talked about. So now that we talked about all of them, we can actually better divide them into categories. And the first category is going to be of those that actually can be used as source operands, and in this category, all of the memory addressing types are going to fit in, whereas we can only use the first four, so register mode, indexed mode, symbolic mode, and absolute mode for destination operands. Something that I haven't told you so far is the fact that you can use these addressing modes interchangeably. So in case of addressing modes which work for both source and destination operands, you can mix and match. You don't have to use the same addressing mode for both of the operands. If you want to experiment with addressing modes at home, you don't even need a development board. All you need is a computer with an IDE, you have to write some C code, then you have to enable the generation of assembler code after you're writing your C code, and then all you have to do is look at that assembler code and see how the different addressing modes are being used to implement your C code. Furthermore, I'd recommend you guys start an assembler project yourself, write some assembler instructions, just so that you can get a feel for how these memory addressing modes work. And this is going to immensely help you out when you're going to read assembler code in the future. I hope you guys found this video useful. Today we talked about the different memory addressing types available, we divided them into categories, and we talked about how you can experiment with them right at home. If this information helped you out, make sure to like this video, share with your friends, and hit the subscribe button and that bell icon so you don't miss any future videos. As always, in the description you can find links to the Texas Instruments MSP430 development board, and even though it's not necessary for this video, I do recommend you guys buy it because it's about $20 and it's pretty much one of the best investments you're going to do when trying to learn embedded systems. There's also going to be links to my Embedded Systems Explained playlist, so if you missed any of the other videos, make sure to check those out. Anyways, I'll catch up with you in the next video when we are going to talk about microcontroller low power modes. Stay tuned.